Well, sweet. You want to jump in?
Yep.
Well, we'll get started. So thanks again for being with us. Obviously, I'm Ronnie. This is Mel. And we've been doing this every Saturday for the last few weeks. And we're going to continue to do this while we are all on quarantine and at home through this crazy time. So we hope you guys are doing well. We hope you guys are safe and healthy. I know you wanted to.
Well, so, let us know real quick where you guys are watching from. We love seeing you guys watch from all over the world. Mm-hmm. Already we've got Shogo from Kenya. We have someone from the Netherlands.
Arizona. Israel, yeah.
That's awesome. Cool. So we got everyone. Love the hoodies. Thanks, Eric.
Yeah, representing.
So I'm actually going to do a little thing this week. I'm going to answer two questions from last week that I didn't get to, because I always go through all the questions, and a lot of times we only can answer, you know, the first few that come in. So, but there were some that I really liked and I thought that you guys would like too. So we're going to answer those. But if you guys do have questions, make sure to put them in here. We've got people from all over, from India,
Louisiana, New Jersey. Big Feist. Oh. Big Feist. My dad's in here. Big Ron.
Oh,
we
got the family event here. I mean, yeah, you know, we're all stuck
that's too
at home.
Funny.
So.
Finland, Riverside, Cali. There we go. England, Oklahoma City.
So
that's
fun.
So cool. UK.
So hi, Josh and Callie. So you guys put your questions in here, and then I'm going to be looking through these, but we'll answer the two from last week. So put your questions in. If you're excited to jump in, hit the thumbs up, and let's jump in. So I'm pretty sure it was Kat Allen, who I think I saw. You're here again. I'm pretty sure you were the one that sent me this question, but she asked us what we do outside of this YouTube channel. Like, do we have jobs? Mm-hmm. Is this all we do?
This takes up a lot of time for sure. Mm-hmm. So not only do we have the Ronnie and Mel page, I have a personal page on YouTube as well, the Ronnie Faisst page, which is takes up time. But we really focus on this as our ministry, YouTube, to share the gospel, and we spend a whole lot of time filming and editing. But I also do real estate investing, and I'm actually launching RFMX, Ronnie Faisst Motocross, motocross schools. Actually, I was planning on doing my first class in May, but now because of everything that's going on, I'm kind of putting it on hold. But I'm going to start doing coaching, start teaching kids how to ride and just better their skills. Or actually, not just kids, anyone who wants to learn. I want to teach people. I had an amazing career. It's what I did for a living before we did YouTube. Did a 20-year professional motocross career. And now that I'm retired and we're doing this, I wanna share what I learned and give that back to the community of the motocross industry. So I wanna help people. So I'll be doing that. And
you love doing that.
No, I love it. I love riding. I'm always gonna ride. And to be able to share what I learned over my, been riding for over 30 years, to be able to share that with people. And then I just can see kids where I was. I went to motocross school, so I remember what that was like. And now I'm able to be on the other end. So. Mm-hmm. I love it.
Mm-hmm. And you're so good with the kids.
Yeah.
They love you.
I love kids. I'm a big kid, that's why.
Uh-huh. Yeah, but I mean, to be honest, this is basically what I do full time. So
for real.
Everything that you see, whether it's from the YouTube channel to the website to, you know, the social media pages, that's what I do all day. So.
Well, it's just a lot comes with it. I mean, YouTube is a lot, and just staying on top of just, it's not just YouTube. There is, you got to do the Facebook, you got to do Instagram, you got to do Twitter. There's so much with social media now. And then having the Ronnie and Mel, and then having my personal stuff, it is a lot of work. It keeps us busy. Like, we really, and then there's just more that goes with just doing the YouTube, because it's not like we just do YouTube. We do travel sometimes. We're trying not, like, we made it, oh, well, I can't travel now with what's going on. But even before that, we were like, maybe we shouldn't travel for like 6 months this year and wait till the end of summer, because it does get us behind. But last year we traveled to different events and spoke. She spoke at some women's conference. I did some men's conference. And so there's that. And so there's other stuff that goes with it.
Because at the end of the day, we're not really like Christian YouTubers necessarily. Like, YouTube is just the platform that we use to do ministry. We do ministry. And so the ministry comes with so many more things than just the YouTube channel. So we're always trying to come up with new ways to help people grow, help get the message out, help reach people. So so there's just a lot that goes with it.
Mm-hmm. And there's things coming. Do I want to tell them about what you've been working on?
No,
you're keeping the secret? Because it's part of the ministry. She's been working on a 1-year Bible plan from Genesis to Revelation, and it's a lot of work. I'm like, it's so many videos. But it, hopefully, we're hoping it'll be available by January of next year. But I don't know, because it's so much work. But that, when she's not, if we're not filming and editing for this channel, she has been just spending a whole lot of time studying and preparing that. So,
well, filming and editing. And editing that more stuff. Too,
yeah. So. And then same thing. If I'm not doing this, I will be doing filming and editing for my personal channel. So it,
we're busy,
like nonstop. YouTube takes up a lot of time.
Yeah. So, and then someone else asked, and I wish that I could have gotten written down their name, but they asked, what is, I don't know if they were asking, like, during this time where we all have to stay at home, what our normal routine is, but they were just asking, what does, like, your daily routine look like? And to be honest, since we work from home, it looks exactly the same, for me at least.
Yeah, you like to be home. I mean, we're still, we have certain things that are, like, an everyday thing. Like I would say, we always wake up, we always have coffee, we always, the news, she'll kick on the news, we'll hang out down here for a second, and then we'll go up and spend time with the Lord. I normally go in the prayer room. She set up a little office in our master, and she's been kind of getting away. We used to be together in the prayer room together, and then we did that for a season, but right now we've been kind of separated. I've been in the prayer room by myself, and she's been in our master, and she just has a little desk set up in there now, and she spends time in there. And then once that is done, we normally get to work at whatever needs to be done for the day. And then, you know, we have a couple meetings during the week together and go through, this is what needs to be done. This is where we're at. We have checklists and kind of like, this is what needs to be done for the ministry. This is what needs to be done for both pages, my personal stuff. This is where we're at. Like we've been working on merch. This is where we're at on the merch. This is where we're at on the Bible. And so we kind of go through everything that needs to be done. And then we just kind of tackle it. And I go to the gym every day, other than obviously right now I've been working out at home, but that is in my daily routine. And then in between really our morning coffee, time with Jesus, and the gym, I kind of fit in whatever's on that to-do list for the day. Like I'm really good about, we both are, we have a list for the week, we have a list for the days, and we know exactly what we're doing and what needs to be done each day. Mm-hmm. And we kind of fit whatever that day is, there's those tasks for the ministry or the other stuff. So
I have working out on my to-do list every day. It just,
you do it sometimes.
Never happens.
She does it like once a month.
I know, it's still, it's like once a week. Like I'm supposed
she's
to
been
do
doing
it.
Better lately. Like you had like a nice really long delay. I was like, what happened to the workout? She was
well,
doing too good
sick.
And then she like
I got like yeah, the yeah, flu and then I got sick after that. So
she's making a comeback. It's a strong comeback right
once
now.
Once a week comeback, but you know, I try. So so all right. Someone.
All right, so let's get to some questions for this week.
Yes.
That was just last week. She was just kind of wanted to fill you in. Just get to know you guys a little bit better. That's kind of what we do outside of seeing you guys here, you know?
Gracious Wives Club, come as you are, said she likes the God Vibes mug.
Oh, yeah.
We will also have coffee mugs available when our little store is actually about to come out.
Hopefully soon.
So Loyal Daughter asks, and I think I had another question. Might have been by the same person. Nope, different person, but they're basically the same question. They ask, I would like to know about your long distance relationship, what it looked like as friends, long distance, getting to know each other.
Well, we knew each other before we started dating, because me and her originally met 8 years ago before either of us were Christians. So I knew her. But then we had 8 years, we didn't even talk. Mm-hmm. And then we reconnected. And then obviously when we reconnected, she was here in Kansas and I was in California. So she had so many like boundaries. I don't know if you guys have watched all the boundary stuff, but she had so many boundaries while we were in our friendship and in our dating that I don't feel like we talked a ton on the phone. You know, we did, but it wasn't overkill. I would fly her out to California maybe once a month. Was it once a month?
Is this when we were dating or when we were? So when we were friends,
she has a better memory.
We went to we would go to a lot of different Christian conferences and events, so that we were in places where we were getting to know the Lord, but then we were kind of there together, so that in that safe setting we could get to know one another really well.
Just reconnect and kind of, because she was a completely different person when we reconnected, and so was I, obviously.
Yeah.
So it was, we were still, even though we knew each other, it was still getting to re-know each other once again. And yeah, Christian events, we did a ton of those. But yeah. I remember flying you out. But on some of those times I flew you out, we were going to events. It's not like you just came out. We went to Azusa together.
But we were dating then.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay, sorry. I'm jumping ahead again.
You have to understand, he's hit his head a lot of times. He's had a lot of concussions, so he really does forget things.
To tell the story.
No, but that was when
we were dating. Okay. We talked a little bit, but it was more about the Lord.
It was intentional.
Yeah, she was more, yeah, there was...
And we knew that we were going to probably end up dating, at least just to like see. So we actually started both reading a book together that sort of prepared us.
The Right One, I think it was called.
Yeah, to how to date healthily.
What would a Christian relationship look like?
So then we would talk about that too, just to prepare us to date. But I would say our friendship really kind of was... figuring out, are we gonna actually date? Like, it was all very intentional, and we knew where the Lord might have been leading it, but we just were trying to really figure it out and use wisdom.
And so. did we fast during friendship, or did we fast during dating? I can't remember. I know we did fast on each other.
Yeah, I think that we did fast a little bit right before dating, but I think it was because I prayed about it, and then the Lord told you about it.
Yeah. But I wanted to say that because why we did fast from each other, we would journal. Like, she's really good at journal. I was never a big journaler, but why we fasted, I would write down certain things. And the cool part about that was, we would, do a week or 3 days or whatever we decided the fast was going to be. And then when we would come back together, we would share some of the things that the Lord had spoken. And it was just cool to kind of see how the Lord would kind of speak into both of us about certain things. And so... Mm-hmm. I actually, even though that sounds kind of intense, it was really cool. I've never done that with anyone before.
You were scared.
I was a little nervous. I was like, wait, what if she don't like me at the end of the 7 days? What if the Lord tells her to run?
but that's all about surrendering it always to the Lord, trusting that He's going to speak to us, that it's not like something we have to do in and of ourselves to make the relationship work, that it's actually... laying that down to allow God to speak to both of us separately and let it happen.
So. But I felt like it kind of brought us closer. It almost gave me more confidence, like, the man of the Lord's in this. There were things that were spoken to both of us. We were like, whoa, that was pretty cool. So I think that was cool.
Mm-hmm. So Brian asks, different question, what do you do when you are afraid of trusting God with your future? But I mean, that kind of actually goes along with sort of what we were just saying about laying things down, trusting.
So what do you do when you're afraid of trusting God?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a tough question. I mean, it is. It's a surrender, really. Mm-hmm. There means there's just come a point where you have to just kind of let go and just step out in faith and say, like, I'm going to trust. You know, the Bible says we walk by faith, not by sight. There comes, so much of our relationship with the Lord is in faith. And I think trusting Him is a big part of faith.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, Lord, I know you're real. I know you hear me. Things might not look the way things sometimes don't look like you hear. Sometimes it looks like He's not around. Like, Lord, where'd you go? And just believing that He's there. It's a journey of faith. So I don't know. You got anything better than...
Well, I always like to say, because I even said it at the end of my... testimony video, if you've watched it, I think a lot of times we want to write our own story, and we're like afraid that if we surrender our life and our future and our story to God, like, it won't be good, or that it won't be what our definition of good is. But I think when we actually realize that God is who He says He is, He's actually better than we can even imagine. And when we surrender it to Him, He actually will write a better story than we could ever imagine. Mm-hmm. And sometimes that looks different than what we would want it to look like. But God always knows what's best for us. And He's looking at a different lens than us. We're sometimes thinking about my happiness here, now, the next year, the next 5 years. But God's looking at a much bigger picture of I want your life to look good for eternity. You know, God's looking at the eternal view of our life, not just this really temporary. He's in control. It's much better if He's in control of my life than if I'm in control. If I take the pen and try and write it myself, He's going to let me. Like, He's going to just let me go and be like, okay, you figure out your own little life because I'm taking it back. And there's that verse in Matthew 16 that in those early days following the Lord, I always thought of, and it's basically, if you hang on to your life, it's you're going to lose it. Oh, did you use that?
No, I was waiting for you to stop talking so I could say that.
But it's true.
That is it.
I had that verse like plastered on my wall right next to me, and every day I would just remind myself, okay, if I lose my life for his sake, I'm actually going to gain life. Mm-hmm. And so, but if I hold on to my life, then I'll actually lose it.
But that's surrender.
It's surrender.
It's surrender, it's but it's surrender. In faith. You're surrendering in faith that you believe that God, is, that you trust God and his leadership over you trying to do it your way. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm saying. It comes down to just surrendering and believing and trusting in faith. Why'd you jack my verse?
I'm so excited
to say that. I'm like, oh, I got a good verse for this. You got me. You're getting good. The Spirit's coming through you, huh? She always says I can come up with the verses, and I'm like, oh, so I was waiting. I'm like, okay, I got a good verse for this.
Well, no, he has this weird gift where he can memorize verses. Like, you could point, what's that tattoo say? You know, you've got a verse like there, and he can like just say it. Like, and you can read something, and you can like.
I don't know how, because I can't remember to do the simple thing, so I gotta write everything down on my phone, forget everything, but I remember verses. But I always forget where they're at in there. I gotta get better at the address.
Yeah, I don't know.
Like, I could say that same verse you just quoted, but what is the actual book and chapter and verse? I don't know, but I know it's in there.
If you hold on
to your life, you'll lose it, but if you lose your life, you'll find it.
We had someone email us this week, and they were so sweet. They actually asked us, like, I never remember where things are in the Bible. Like, is that bad? And I'm like,
Welcome.
Just so that you know, like, the Bible, it originally never had chapter and verse breakings in
That's true.
So that actually isn't inspired. They were just stories.
It just helps us find things.
It's just for reference
to
help other people find them. But if you don't know them, I think it's fine.
It's cool when you can remember them, though, because you're like, oh, I know exactly where it's at, and you can just turn to
it.
But I think
some people use it as a puffing themselves up in pride. Like, oh, I know where that verse is, So I think that there's two ways of that. So Jeremy asks, what was it like when the two of you got saved? But to be honest, we're actually going to be filming a video about that tomorrow, which will come out next week. And so we're actually going to break down for you guys what our life literally looked like when we got saved, how we got free from our past life, what we had to do to kind of move on into our new life in Christ. So we will answer that question fully.
You're leaving them hanging?
Well, we're going to answer it in a week. But I like that question.
Raise my hand, come back next week and watch.
No, but because we're going to break it down even more and even better for you. So
we'll give them a little snippet. All right, so I'll just give you this. We have completely different testimonies. I came to the Lord, stayed in my industry, and had to wrestle through it, highs and lows, struggling, failing, 5 steps forward, 3 back, and keep going, failed my way forward, and I made breakthrough and been able to have a transformed life. She got saved, got radically transformed, taken out of the world that she was in, got to be a part of a strong Christian community, and then obviously radically transformed.
But
they're completely different, and I think it's kind of cool because there's some amazing like deliverance stories like you. Mm-hmm. But I'm like, man, I didn't get the deliverance story. I didn't have like get saved and boom, everything was gone. Like I got saved and was still in the world surrounded by a ton of unbelievers and didn't have a strong Christian community around me. And I had to figure out how do I walk with Jesus now in this world where there's not a whole lot of people doing this. Mm-hmm. So it was a different experience, but God was faithful to just be patient with me and bring me through. It took time, though.
But I think part of my story that I don't really talk about often, because I feel like he's still even been unfolding it lately, is that in my radical salvation, radical deliverance, just totally, you know, set on the Lord, I actually kind of stumbled the other way and went into pride thinking, how awesome am I? Like, I'm the best Christian. All those other people, why can't they get it together? I just got radically saved. Why don't they love Jesus as much as I do? And so that's even been another part of my story that's a little bit different. But
so we'll go into detail if you guys want to check back next week and just kind of talk about the whole experience of what it was like for her experience and what mine was like. But I testify that God is kind, he is faithful, he is patient, and he loves us right through it, even when we're weak and broken. And you just stay steady, just stay with it. That's my That is what I've learned. Just stay with it. Stay in the battle, stay in the fight, and God is faithful to bring you out.
There's a good question here. It's I think a girl asking it, but I think it could go for both ways. It says, how can I learn not to look at guys lustfully? I'm in prayer and communion with God continually, but I still struggle. Any advice? And I think, again, guys, I think, struggle.
Probably with that more than girls. Yeah. Well, it's probably on both sides. I mean, but it's a real thing for men, most men. That's, a lot of guys struggle. It's hard. I mean, look at the world we live in. It's just all in your face. It's everywhere, you know? Even at the gym, you go to the gym and just... There's just pretty girls in really little clothes. It's like, whoa,
you can't even like turn
it's social everywhere.
Media
so it's
on
for both of us. Guys struggle with probably just as much or more.
So I think one thing that is just coming to my mind is there's a verse in Psalm 119. It's like the longest psalm in the world. But in it, it says, how can a man keep his way pure? And it's by meditating on his law day and night. So in my mind, the more that we get our eyes on Jesus, the more we immerse ourselves in the Word of God, in His righteousness, in His holiness. I think I said it last time that whatever we behold, we become. So if we behold the one that is holy, if we behold the one that is pure, the more we do that, the more we are going to become pure because we're going to be continually transformed into that same image. Actually, I think this is my course. This wasn't on here that I was talking about, but I was doing a little sermon in my course, but that's what that's about. So, so advice for those that are trying to kind of get over that. Sometimes I think we can focus on don't look, but rather it's just, no, just change your vision. Look at the right thing and continually just keep looking at Jesus, staring into His Word, meditating on His Word, and then you will be transformed.
But I think it's okay to have that, I'm not going to look. If you know that's your weakness, then know like, okay, when it's when you're faced with the opportunity to look, turn the other way. Like I've had to do that. I've had to do that at the gym. It's like, I'm like, I don't want to fall into, so then I just will turn the other way, go the other way. And it's a choice and it's a battle. And you get, sometimes you'll be able to, you know, go hard for 3-4 months and then all of a sudden you start catching yourself going back and you just sign back up and you just keep fighting it. And as you're doing it, staying refocused on the Lord and in time you can, it's the stay in the fight. It's some battles are harder to win than others, but you can overcome and you can win through the power of the Spirit. You just got to stay in it and just keep fighting it. If you got to look away, look away. You know, that's what, and I think when Jesus said, hey, if your eye calls you to sin, gouge it out. If your hand calls you to sin, cut it off. And that's that really intense, like, just stop.
Yeah.
Kill it at the root.
Don't put yourself in the environment where you
know
you're
going to
stumble.
Like, yes, focus your eyes and look to something much more better than what's causing you to stumble.
But also say no.
Have the attitude that like when I see it, I'm going to say no and look the other way. In a sense, I'm going to fight it. I'm going to go and try to cut it off at the root.
There's actually a verse in Job, I think it is, and he says, I have basically made a covenant that I will not sin with my eyes. Like I will not even, you know, but I think it's the second look that is sin. The first one, there's going to be things that come at you either way, but it's like when you like just give into it is
it's a wrestle.
But it's a battle.
It's
both for guys and for girls. And then I think it's too, just not letting your, because it's kind of like what you focus on, you get your thoughts start getting involved. So once your thoughts start getting involved and you start thinking about things,
another verse. It says the eye is the lamp of the body, and if the eye is good, the whole body is good. But if the eye is bad, the whole body is bad. It's true, because what you look at is really where you will go. It's like where you begin to look, it's kind of, that's why she's saying get your focus on Jesus, because if you begin to just stare at Jesus, stare at His Word, and get your eyes set on Him, usually you'll just be led away from the stuff. But if you're constantly looking at the stuff that's causing you to stumble, eventually you just go there. I've wrestled with that and stumbled because of that. So I feel you.
Okay, here is another question. I'm going to answer my mom's question. This is a cute question. She said, is Palm Sunday just a Catholic celebration? And I would say, maybe the working out of it is, but I think the remembrance of actually what happened on Palm Sunday is a universal thing, because Palm Sunday was when Jesus walked into Jerusalem, and it basically was right before he was going to go to the cross. The rest of it, he was walking into Jerusalem knowing this week they're going to kill me and it's all going to happen. But it, as he was walking in, the people were saying, you know, blessed, you know, blessed Hosanna. Be, yeah, Hosanna, you know, and basically saying, you're the Messiah, you're the guy. But it, those same exact people were the ones that by Friday were, yeah, were yelling, crucify him, crucify him. And so I think Palm Sunday is, whether you're Catholic or Christian, I think it's a good time to just remember what he did, even as we are entering that week, you know, even on Good Friday. I think it's so good to remember the cross, remember what Jesus did, and go through the Gospels, read those stories again, and just be reminded of what Jesus did that last week of his life before he gave his life for us. So.
Good job.
Well, you got to say something because.
What? Nah, you killed it. That was a good one. What, are you looking for a question?
Yes, so yeah, that's why you need to tell them something.
What do you want to tell them? We got our bean stand again, our lentils. We got our little, we're camera set up on the bean stand.
Oh yeah, if you guys like saw what it looks like, just it's, we're so amateur when it comes to like camera things. Like we have a camera stand right now that it's literally Costco.
It's just an iPhone. We're just using an iPhone.
Yeah, it's
no
just my
fancy
phone.
Camera. We got the iPhone, this little tripod, and it's on a box of beans. And then we just got this little cheap diva light. It's nothing
so
high
funny.
Class, no.
And then we've got these little like iPhone microphones that don't even work that well, sorry.
Oh no, that's all good. Hey,
but
we're,
hey,
we're doing it.
We vowed when we first started this YouTube channel, we just said, Lord, we are just going to start with where we're at and what we have. And we'll build from there. We'll get better someday. Like
we'll buy better equipment, but right now we're just using what we got.
This is what we got, so... That's so funny. So Nuria, I think I'm saying your name right, says, I'm trying to build my relationship with God, but at the moment, my husband does not believe in him. Do you have any advice for me?
My mom's in the same situation. My mom's a believer and her husband's an unbeliever. And I think just staying, what was exactly the question? I don't want to answer it wrong.
It's basically, what do you do?
When you're
trying to build your relationship with God, but your husband
is not.
Yeah,
I would just say keep building, keep staying steady, keep loving Jesus, keep. And the Bible says if you're married to an unbeliever, then you are to be that light to him. So, you know, it talks about being equally yoked. But if you're already in that relationship, you are to stay in it. You are to honor your husband and keep loving him. But I would definitely say don't. Turn away from the Lord. Stay steady, stay in the Word, stay in prayer, and just live out your life and continue to pray for your husband. I know my mom's been praying for her husband for over 10 years, and he's still not a believer, but we believe maybe someday he will turn. So I wouldn't give up. Just, you know, there is, God can move in prayer and God can do things. So just stay steady and just stay with it. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
You got anything?
I think I would just add to, I'm pretty sure it's in 1 Corinthians where it talks all about
love.
Well, oh, and no, if you're married to an unbeliever and those things, and that it even says not only can you be a light to your husband, I mean, it almost sounds like in there that if you are saved, your husband almost could, like, I don't know. Yeah, it almost like sounds like that.
I would have to look at the chapter.
But so don't let the fact that your husband, who is in a sense your leader, is not leading you
spiritually,
because all of us have to stand before God and give an account for our lives. And, you know, you're not going to be able to say, well, I didn't follow you, God, or try and grow in you because my husband did. Like, we each individually have to stand before God. And so God sees your heart to know him. God sees your reach to know him. And so know that in you reaching, it could impact your husband. But even if it doesn't, it impacts your eternal destiny with you and Jesus. And that is what is most important. So, I would just advise you, keep doing it, keep growing, keep praying for your husband that he would turn and that you could even be a light to him, that you could serve him in different ways. So that's really what I would say.
Mm-hmm.
Chrissy, she asks, how did you guys know when God's timing was right? Meaning the timing of you moving forward into engagement, marriage. How did we know?
How did we know? What was the, well, I feel like there was just, there was a lot. Like we, I mean, I had dreams. Mm-hmm. There were certain dreams where the Lord was speaking to me through dreams. There was even, people would come up and just give us almost like a word that would kind of confirm certain things that we were praying about. So there was a lot of things. The Lord spoke in a whole different lot of ways. And I probably, if I shared them all, you would probably be like, well, he's kind of goofy. Like, I feel like the Lord speaks to me in numbers. He does. There was just a lot of stuff, but I felt confident because I'll be honest with you. I was nervous about marriage just because my family was divorced and I never seen that modeled in my family. So I wasn't sure, like, man, is this going to work? So I was nervous about it. But as we dated and as the Lord kind of confirmed things, I became more confident that the Lord was in it and he was approving of it. And I believe that if you invite him in, he can show you that he is in it. And I think that's kind of what he did with me. And it gave me the confidence, okay, if the Lord's in it, the Lord created marriage. And if you're in it, Lord, and we keep you in the center, then this is, it's going to work. Mm-hmm. And I just had to trust the Lord. And so, I don't know, did I answer the question? Was that an answer? I hope that was the answer. Or you're looking for, you give her something. What was a good, I know there was, what was the, when did we decide to go from friends to dating? Like, what happened?
Well, I remember.
Because I know there was, I just have a bare memory.
I remember when we went from friends to dating, one, we were preparing to date, so we knew that that was something, if the Lord really confirmed it, that we were probably going to be led into. But I remember we went on a 3-day fast, or maybe that was the 7-day fast, I can't remember. And God gave me a dream and you that it was almost in the friendship zone, the way that our hearts were moving forward, it actually wasn't safe anymore to not be under any kind of commitment of a dating relationship. So it just, the Lord made it clear to me, okay, I actually want you to move into the commitment and the mm-hmm. safety of getting to know each other and share your hearts to where, you know, it's not a scary thing. So mm-hmm. I remember that was when we moved into dating. Mm-hmm. And then...
Yeah, but how did we go from dating to engagement? What was the next?
It was...
She journaled all this, and I'm sure there was things, but... And I might be jumping ahead, but when we finally did get engaged, and this even gave me more confidence, because like I said, I was a little nervous. When we did get engaged, we got engaged in Washington, D.C., I had no plan on where to do it. Originally, I was going to do it here because she likes trees and green, so I was going to try to get engaged in Kansas City, and the ring never got done when I was here on a trip, so I obviously couldn't drop a knee with no ring. So the next time we were going to be together was at this big event in Washington, D.C. Was it called The Call? The Call? Mm-hmm. Is that what it's called?
It was something different, whatever.
But anyway, it was a big gathering of Christians, hundreds of thousands of people, and I didn't know where to go. I prayed, Lord, lead me. And he actually led me to this little like courtyard. But anyway, when I dropped the knee, I had my friend with an iPhone. I'm like, take the picture. He took the picture. And I don't know if anyone's ever seen the video, or it's probably in our story video. And maybe we can, I don't know if we can put it in.
I can link it.
Maybe we can, yeah, share with you guys.
Anything I talk about, I can link below for you guys.
But I kneeled down in this green garden, and right in the middle of me and her, where I decided to kneel down, I had no clue. I didn't know Washington, D.C. from anything. It was all city. Like, I'm walking around the city going, where, she wants trees, Lord. There's no trees here. And all of a sudden, I found this courtyard just on this random walk. But right in the middle of us is this red flowers just randomly in the middle. And I, like, when I looked at that, like, I cried. Like, I did, I cried. I looked at that photo and it just touched me because I was like, to me, the Lord was saying, I'm in this. Like,
I'm in the center.
Yeah, I'm in this. It was like that red tree to me reminded me of the blood of Jesus. Like, he was in the center. We kept him in the center all through our friendship, all through our dating. And even like he is the center, and mm-hmm. I just had confidence, like, and I, that's what I'm saying, like, if you invite him in and you let him lead, like, he'll do cool things like that to where you'll know like the Lord's in it and he's mm-hmm. with you. And but anyway, I wanted to share that just because that was like a cool moment for me, just going, okay, like, the Lord's with us. And I think when you honor him through the whole dating process, like, he'll put it, it's not that he's saying like she's the one, he's just saying, no, I approve. You guys are doing it godly. I approve. Mm-hmm. It's like, because we don't want to, I don't know if we can get into all that, but the whole one thing, she don't believe
or
in
this,
the soulmate.
Like, that there's only one.
Yeah, so I don't know, he's saying like, that's the one, get the one. I think he was just approving of how we walked it out in our relationship, and he's saying, yes, I approve, and I think he orchestrated us together. I think he obviously mm-hmm. knew. God knows all things. Mm-hmm. Well, but it was a cool moment, cool picture. It really touched me. And even when I look at it, I don't look at it all the time, but even when I see it, it's just a really cool memory going like, I could have kneeled down anywhere, and I couldn't have made that happen. Mm-hmm. Like, I can't, mm-hmm. you know what I mean? How did that happen? Like, my friend was at the right angle that this red flower tree is right in the middle. It just resembles the blood of Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I would just add one thing about when we knew it was time to get engaged. We basically prayed about God. We don't want our marriage just to be for us and about what we want in life. We want it to be to glorify you. So, and we want to serve you all of our days. So if you want us to get married for the sake of doing ministry and serving you in the way that we think we're supposed to, like, would you confirm that you actually are inviting us to serve you as a married couple? And the crazy thing was he did the very next day. He confirmed it in a huge, crazy way. Like, he sent someone and they told us, you guys are going to start a YouTube channel. You guys are going to touch people. Like, they didn't even know us. They, out of nowhere, they came and they just spoke like the word of the Lord over us the very next day. And so we just knew it was an invitation from God that together as a married couple that we were going to serve him. But I mean, I don't want just like the crazy words to like, if you don't get those, to be like, yeah. Well, God didn't speak directly to me like that. Like, God gives us wisdom. The Holy Spirit gives us wisdom. And if you, like, find someone that they love God, you love God, and God just confirms his little smile that, like, he approves, like, mm-hmm. I think we get to make those choices in the best way that we know how, like, through prayer, through wisdom, through getting other people to speak into our lives, like, because we did all that too. Like, we had mm-hmm. other people speak into our lives to be like, is this wisdom? Mm-hmm. And because I think God really, God sometimes does give us decisions. This is I would say marriage is a decision, and he values our decision, but he loves when we try and walk it out with wisdom. So I would just say wisdom. Always look to wisdom, look to what the Bible says, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. get godly people to speak into your life. Yeah. One thing I want to say thank you to is Jeremy Trailer. He gave us $20.
Oh, really?
Towards some new camera equipment.
Hey,
that's amazing.
He's like, hey, step up the iPhone.
I know, right?
Those mics are so good. Thank you, dude.
No, I really appreciate it. No, because we actually do need to get some.
No, we
our
actually
stuff is sad.
we need it. No, I know. We have talks of starting a podcast. That's also on our list of things that we want to do as well, and we need better mics to do that, because our wireless mics broke. That's why we've been using these, because one broke anyway, so mm-hmm. we can't use it. Then we had this like little boom thing, and it
doesn't work for podcasts.
Yeah, it doesn't really work good for podcasts, but anyway, it's another thing on the to-do list, podcast. Uh-huh. We're trying to think of a cool name, so if you guys have any ideas of cool names, what should we call it? Because we've been praying about what can we call the podcast.
Mm-hmm. Real quick, Josh and Kaylee, they asked, what was the name of the book? I'm thinking you're referring to the one that we read before we were going to date. It's called The Right One. And after this, I can link it down below. Or if you go to our website, I have a whole page. If you go to our website, it's like ronnieandmel.com/recommended resources or just resources. I have a whole page of all the books we recommend, all of our favorite things that we've read, you know, as we've grown in the Lord. But Eric, our buddy Eric, he asks,
is it Eric Davis?
Yeah.
What up, buddy?
So what's your favorite part about doing ministry on YouTube and Instagram?
What is the favorite part? I honestly just think being able to reach people all around the world. Mm-hmm. I think that's what blew us away, because we had no idea what we're doing. I didn't realize how strong and how powerful YouTube really was until we got started. Like, we didn't know. And then as this thing began to grow, we were consistently doing it week after week, and then we start getting emails and comments, and we're like, whoa, these people are from all around the world, and like, we were like blown away. Mm-hmm. So I think that doing ministry as a married couple and being able to just share just right here in our home in Kansas City, simple, just We love Jesus. We're passionate about the word. Just be able to share our stories, share what we learned through the Bible, and then just see it reach people all around the world. Mm-hmm. I think that's amazing. Yeah. I think it's awesome.
And I think what is cool too, sometimes this is a negative, but also to see the feedback of people like you that, you know, you can tell us your story of how you've been changed, of how you've grown in the Lord. And some, and you know, some comments you read and they just crush you, but other comments,
yeah,
like,
it's all good.
They fuel you to be it really is making a difference. And if I can just reach the one person that it matters, you know, so yeah, I've.
So thank all you guys for subscribing. Thank all of you guys for just being here week after week. I'm just glancing at my phone. Patrick is always with us.
Always.
See him on everyone. So just we recognize you guys. We see you guys. And we're so thankful for everybody that is just supports us and has been there. And we're gonna keep doing it. That's what we made it a commitment. It's been a year now. April. We started
April
in April.
April 9th will be our 1 year.
Oh, yeah.
We launched
this.
Yeah, we launched this April 9th of last year.
So, yeah, we're like right at the 1 year mark. Mm-hmm. And we're going to keep going. So, we have no plan of stopping it. And we're going to just keep building. We're going to, like I said, hopefully podcasts will come maybe this year. And then we're going to start, like I said, she'll have that, the 1 year Bible plan. And she's an amazing writer. Like, she has so many more gifts than me. So she'll be writing books and doing all this cool stuff. Like, she wants to do a devotional. So it's all coming. It's just, obviously, we only can do so much. And we're trying to be steady at this. So as we grow, there'll be more and more stuff to help minister to you guys.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Patrick, I didn't even want to attempt to say your last name. It's Patrick A. But man, I was like, I'm going to mess that up.
That's funny.
But you know who you are, buddy.
Okay, let's do one more question. And Kat asks, how did you guys get past the fact that you dated when you were younger or before Christ? I guess, how did we get over?
Wait, tell me the question again. How did we get over?
How did we get past the fact that we dated when we were younger and before Christ? So I would just say the way that we got over it, I mean, for one, the Lord spoke this phrase to us over and over again when we first reconnected, when we were friends, even then again when we got engaged with the blood red flowers in the middle of our engagement photo. God kept just shouting the phrase, beauty from ashes, and that we kind of looked at our, when we kind of dated before we knew Jesus, as like, it was like ashes. But from that, God created something beautiful. Mm-hmm. That because we actually knew each other back then when we were broken, it actually made the story and God's redemptive power that much more beautiful, and our story that much more beautiful, because God can take two people who were completely far from him, who were completely in sin, and he can bring them to this other place where they love Jesus, they love righteousness, they love purity, and they can stay, you know, pure till their wedding day. And so we didn't look at it as like a negative thing. Mm-hmm. We actually looked at it as a beautiful God redemption thing. So I think that's how I would say.
Trophies of grace. That's what we all are, trophies of grace. But yeah, I was just, I mean, the verse popped in my head. Anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all things become new. So our past is our past. And it even says in the Bible that he has forgiven our sins and he's remembered them no more, as far as the east is from the west. So if God has forgotten her past and he's forgotten my past, then I just let it go. I know who she is now and how much she loves the Lord, and she's solid. So it's, and same thing with me. Like, my past is probably worse than hers. And we were so, like, even when we came back together, we were so open to lay everything on the table so no one could come up and say, hey, you know, he did this or she did that. Like, we were like, hey, let's just be transparent. I have a really bad past, and so do you. Here it is. And then it's been covered by the blood of Jesus. Let's move forward. But we didn't keep anything. I didn't want her to hear down the road that I so-and-so did this from someone. And then she's like, why didn't you tell me? Like, you know, so we just laid it out. We didn't hide nothing from each other. So I know all of her dirt. She knows all mine. And it's been covered by the blood. And now we're new in Christ. So.
Yeah. And I think that would apply, because we've actually had some questions before of, you know, can I date someone who has, they've had a past, but I didn't. And I would say if they are legit followers of Jesus, then if you still hold them accountable for their sin and point out their sin, then you're actually like disagreeing with Jesus, mm-hmm. because Jesus, if they really have repented and been washed by him,
then they're new.
Jesus doesn't remember their sin. No. He doesn't hold them.
And it says that love, what's the verse?
Covers a multitude of sins.
Love covers a multitude of sin, or love holds, what's?
In 1 Corinthians.
Yeah, love what? 13. Love holds, what is it?
Holds no record of wrong.
Yeah, love holds no record of wrong. That's what I was thinking of. Yeah. But anyway, go ahead, sorry to cut you off. I do that all the time.
So,
I'm mad at that.
So, I think our point here is just that whoever is in Christ, like you said, they are a new creation. We don't need to look at them by their past failures or their past sins because they have been made new. So,
Amen.
All right, sweet. So,
Do you want to do one more? Because it's been about 47 minutes, and we did an hour the first time, and we were like, was that too long? And then we did 30 minutes last week, and then a couple people commented thought it was too short. So this week we're like, hey, let's just shoot for the middle. So let's hit another one, and then we'll let you guys enjoy your Saturday. But thanks again for hanging out.
Well, now I got to find another question.
Oh, sorry. Was that it?
Well, no, there's lots more questions. Okay. I just have to go find one now.
We'll get one more.
You guys are just awesome.
We'll be back again next Saturday. We have a video coming this week, right? We're going to be talking about our past struggles or what it was like when we first got saved, how we overcame the sin that we were in. So we'll be talking about it. It'll be more conversational, and then the following week, I believe we have more of a teaching video coming out.
Jeremy Traylor, he said you couldn't say, I'm not sure if you guys saw our video that we just put out about Ronnie trying to say specifically.
What did I mess up now?
I can't talk.
I couldn't say everything wrong.
You couldn't say journaler.
No, I can't. I can't say journal. I can't even say, I have to try to say something. I say something all the time. And I didn't notice I did this until I started the YouTube channel. I started watching myself on film, and I'm like, I don't even say something right. I'm like, where did I get this language?
You can't talk.
No, I bumped my head. I'm just jacked up. Help me, Lord. Pray for me.
Come
lay some hands on me, Jeremy.
But I think that even shows more of what the Lord can do, because many people in the Bible, they're like, I can't talk.
Yeah,
like
Moses. That's me. Jeremiah, I'm too young. Don't pick me. All of us. All the people God chooses is like, no, you got the wrong guy.
Oh,
someone
my
else. Get
gosh.
Someone else. Get the Bible scholar, not the just dirt bike rider.
That is so funny. I guess maybe we'll just answer this one. From Alexandra, will you guys ever write a book? So you kind of mentioned
She's on it. She's gonna do it for sure. If we'll do one together, maybe. I won't say no, but I know that that's not a strong gifting of mine, but it is. She has all those amazing gifts of writing and teaching and doing all that cool stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But there's definitely, I don't think it's impossible, because you can have people write for you too. Because we've already had a couple people approach us about books, and we just thought it wasn't the right time right now to do it. We actually didn't think we had
don't
the,
have
time.
The time.
We're like, we don't think we can do that right now. So there could, for sure, because I can just share things and have someone write for me. Mm-hmm. So yes, I'd say that is definitely.
Yeah. I would say that I love writing. I think we will absolutely write books. I want to write a 1-year devotional book. I think there would be a cool way to write maybe his story with a lot of like application points for people to grow in their own lives. Same with my story, write my story out, but have it help teach people and bring them into their own identity in Christ, maybe even our story. So I'm sure that along the way, you know, we'll write books, but I mean, I don't know. I think
I'd say yes.
Yeah, I would say yes. So that's fine.
Yes. In the future, things to come. Well,
and
cool.
One more. Gertie just asks, do you like worship music and what bands do you like? And
I love worship music.
We love worship music. It's really all we listen to.
It's all plays.
So, but just in case some of you don't know, at the bottom of our actual YouTube channel, like on the actual Ronnie and Mel channel page, at the very bottom, I actually just keep a worship playlist on there that I update, you know, if a new song comes out that I really like, I put it on that playlist. So if you ever need worship music,
you can find it.
Yeah, those are the ones we listen to almost every day when we, you know,
we listen to the same. I feel like I hear to put the same song on every morning.
Yeah.
Lately, it's been another one standing in the fire next to me. I love that song.
Yep. Awesome. So I think that's it. But again, we just enjoy spending our Saturday mornings with you guys, because I mean, and looking at the news, I mean, we might spend lots of more Saturdays a little bit longer than with we thought. You guys. So, but just continue. I'm just going to encourage you guys. Just continue to be praying for, you know, healthcare workers all throughout the world. You know, the people that are shipping things all over the world, stocking things so we can still eat. Because, you know, there's a lot of people right now that those things are scary. Like a lot of those people are moms and dads and they don't want to get sick. And so just make sure to just really cover people in prayer right now and and serve people wherever you can and do whatever you can for your communities.
So, amen. Yeah. All right. We'll pray. Well, Father, we're so grateful for your love. We're so grateful for your Holy Spirit. We're so grateful for our brothers and sisters all around the world. We're so grateful that we get to do this, Lord. So even in these times, Lord, we look to you. We trust you. We know you are on the throne and you are in control, Lord. So we lift up our brothers and sisters, Lord. We ask for protection. We ask for healing. Strengthen their bodies. Strengthen their hearts, Lord. And fill them with your Holy Spirit and help them to grow in love. Loving you and loving people and shining your light everywhere we go, Lord. So bless today, this week. And we're so excited to love you and to be with you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And Nellie wanted to say
hi. Yay, so the baby girl.
She was taking a little nap.
Oh,
but she came to pray.
She's a good girl.
We love you, Nellie. So we love you guys. And we will see you
shoot
again.
Shoot a thumbs up.
Next Saturday, let us know what you thought. Yep. Let us know if you had additional questions that we didn't really get to. And maybe we'll pick out a few of them from for next week.
Yep.
So we love you guys.
Love you guys.
See ya.
Oh, daddy's girl. Daddy's girl.